We used to give Butch shit when we would work with him because he'd wear a vest. We're like, what's up with the fucking vest? And he goes, I look a little more official, don't I? It's a little more like, you know, I gotta produce the record. I come to work, I wear my vest over the fucking t-shirt. He wasn't your vision of a rock and roll producer, let's put it. But he did have the vest.
We all knew about Butch Vig, but none of us knew who he was or where he came from. Like, he was just sort of this weird sunglasses wearing wizard.
He could take a band like Nirvana and make Nevermind. He could take a band like Sonic Youth and make Dirty. And so you have these bands that are teetering on this, on the brink of chaos, and there's a beauty inside there somewhere, and Butch knows how to target that and just yank it out and blow it up.
Killdozer and, you know, the Sub Pop bands were working with Butch, and then of course Nirvana was working with Butch, and I think I heard the Nirvana demos.
They were like, do you want to work with us on the next record? It was literally that casual because they were hanging out at the studio with Nirvana.
You could tell the guys working there just were not impressed with us or something. Like, we came in and it was just like, hi. I couldn't figure out if they were intimidated or just quiet or what.
They were crazy. It was just a fun, energized record. And it's a total different energy when you have four women feeding off each other in a room and just how they interact.
Tell me about your producer, Butch Vig, and what he brought to the band.
Oh, he's a masturbating animal.
I really try to figure out what the band is trying to achieve and then figure out a way to work with them to get to that level. Everybody I'd run into was, what was L7 gals up to? They had drug dealers coming by the studio, bookies. I don't know how they got involved with bookies.
On one level, he's very comfortable being the guy from the Midwest. You know, he still maintains his Wisconsin accent. He loves his football team. But yet he has a world-class level of talent. The fact that Butch Vig became Butch Vig, nobody knew that at the time. You know, he had a reputation, and you'd meet him and say, oh, that's the guy? He was more like the guy to come clean your pool or something. Hey, how's it going, buddy?
Die Kreuzen or bands like Sonic Youth, I'm sure had a love of some sort of pop music, but couldn't really recognize that element in what they do. But Butch managed to find it and say, like, oh, it's okay. No, it's okay. Do that four times. Don't just do it twice. And simplify and make it sweeter and double that.
Oh, let's try to add a backing vocal. Oh, yeah, let's add another guitar part.
You should try and repeat that or make it more of a chorusy kind of thing.
No, you can do that better. Try it again.
He was able to bring a little bit of that pop passion to those records. Those records rock like hell, but they're really clear.
There's the guitar, there's the bass guitar, there's the drums.
The way that his records were organized, the way that they are trustable and believable makes them durable.
I had heard that Steve Albini used to criticize my production, saying Butch Vig just wants to make every band sound like the Beatles. And there is a little truth to that.
He was never the fast-talking producer. He was never the guy who was going to pump you up for a take or anything like that. He was just very sober, very even-handed, and very steady, very working class.
Butch was one of the first producers to come out of the underground that wanted to turn your noisy garage band into something that the whole world would love.